Ko Huia by Terri Te Tau. Oreo saw a faint impression in the blanket of moss that lay across the path, an outline created by the weight of a foot that had broken through to the mud. She crouched low, pushed aside ferns that brushed her face, and prompted the lens over her right retina to turn on. It brought the imprint into focus and filled in missing information, sketching out the faint outline of a person, someone taller than herself. She swiveled to look back down the trail and stiffened at the sound of rustling leaf litter. Birds called to each other as they returned to roost for the night. No one else could be this far in, she was pretty sure, not without her knowing about it. She'd been so careful. The blocker she'd taken, the pill to keep huia out of her head, meant no one could check in on her. The tree guarding the bones of Oreo's mother lay ahead, hidden behind a curtain of kareau. She'd left before dawn without a whisper to anyone. By now, they'd be worried that she wouldn't be back in time for the release. Night came early to the forest, and even though sunlight still dusted the leaves above the canopy, its thick cover prevented light from reaching the ground below. The trek was mostly uphill and along ridges to her mother's tree. Occasionally, the track dipped into gullies and past streams where she'd refilled her water bottle. A gust of wind with a chill on its edges washed through the canopy. The undergrowth crunched and snapped as Oreo pushed through the bush. Her eyes felt hot and dry. Finally, the giant they called her mother's tree stood above her. Oreo's lens adjusted to compensate for the dark. It allowed her to see the epiphytes carpeting the trunk, networked together in thick arteries and delicate veins. The wakako iwi holding her mother's bones was visible from the ground, the deeply carved lines standing out from the branches. By this time next year, the climbers would have it fully entombed. Her mother's tree was one of the oldest. It had seen the fire that destroyed Te Tāpere Nui o Whatonga and had lived 200 years since. The tree rose high over the canopy, observing the forest creep outwards again, reclaiming the grassland through the work of planterbots and people. She instructed her lens to do a heat scan of the area. Fine, silvery, gridded lines appeared in front of her, tracing the ground surface and then the trees. The lines brushed over different-sized objects in the canopy, birds preparing to roost for the night, kereru, kōkako, and hihi. A large round body that she guessed belonged to a whēkau nestled into a gap in the trunk of her mother's tree. Her mum would like that it had chosen her tree. Oreo wished she could ask it to scout around to find whoever had made that footprint. She cleared a few fallen branches and laid some ponga fern fronds across each other to give her a soft surface. As Oreo did this, she tried to push away intrusive thoughts of tomorrow, the thousands of interested people all linked in with their endless questions. They'd want to know about her mother. Oreo was quite good at relaying what huia told her straight from the prompt on her lens. Huia was great at encouraging her in real time. That's an 89 sincerity score. Pretty good. You'd make a better actor than a biologist, I've always said. It was an instinctive thing to reach out for huia, inherent and habitual. Oreo was doing it now, reaching out with a mental arm to signal the AI. But for the moment, it was severed, cut off by the pill. Huia would have told her who had made the footprint the instant the thought had entered her head. The crisp air bit at the exposed areas of Oreo's skin, her neck and face. She picked up fallen branches and snapped dead ones from small trees, stacking them next to the pile of fern fronds a couple of meters from her mother's tree. The twigs flashed to life as she lit them, orange flames bouncing off the giant trunk. The interwoven vines and plants creating an elaborate shawl across its lower branches. Lydia's body had been lowered into the tree by helicopter. She'd said herself that she didn't want anyone breaking their backs to carry her there. Build a platform and lower me onto it. Easy, just feed me to the birds. She'd croaked to the worried faces gathered around her bed. You'll just have to make sure it's a giant tree, fit for a giant woman. The cold nipped at her again, and with alarm she realized that she was feeling it through her clothes. Her jumpsuit was thin but regulated her temperature, the network of soft green cells collecting energy from the day. The home display on her lens flickered and went out. She sunk into a crouched position next to the fire, trying to think past the panic sweeping through her body. The thin material was a layer of ice against her skin. The feko above sent out a shrill call to let others know it was awake. Oreo flinched at the sound. Without the use of her internal light, the darkness closed in on the weak flames. Oreo dragged the pile of fern fronds to the base of her mother's tree, where the roots created an indent at the bottom. She felt better having the monster tree at her back and the tiny fire between her and the rest of the forest. Her bag was on the ground somewhere, hidden in leaf litter and out of reach. In the bag was a tightly wrapped bundle, the reason for her visit. Oreo was stock-taking specimens in an old freezer when she found the body of the kohuia raised by her mother. She'd called her Tiropi because the baby bird seemed suspicious of the hand puppet she used to feed her, but went along with it anyway. Oreo had quietly decided to bury Tiropi close to her mother. The team would never have agreed, and so she hadn't told them. Oreo threw a log on the fire and watched the flames recoil from the damp wood before leaning back into the nook to wait for sleep. She wished she could send a message up through the epiphytes to her mother's bones, tell her how they were releasing the kohuia all at once and that it was a stupid idea. Lydia would have disapproved of that too, she thought. Safer to do it in small quantities. But now they had 150 birds living in the secured area. They'd had less than half that amount when Lydia died. The birds were doing so well, everyone said. Oreo blew on her fingers and tucked them under her armpits. Hiria would have given her a running commentary of stats if she requested it, all the vital signs and all the unvital ones. She'd be telling her to get up and move around, jog on the spot, and that she needed to be more resilient like her mother. Hiria wasn't supposed to relay the messages which lurked in your subconscious, but sometimes she did. Oreo was pulled from her thoughts by the cries of startled birds in a tree nearby. She remembered the footprint, and that whoever made it could be watching her from beyond the clearing. She wished the blocker would wear off now. She was ready for Hiria to send for help. Every sound beyond the fire echoed, masking whether it was human or animal. The glowing embers faded. Oreo awoke to another cry, this time a karearea searching for its breakfast. It was still mostly dark, but the light had a blueness that revealed the outline of trees beyond the clearing. Her body was a frozen lump, and as she tried to move her toes, sharp jolts of pain assured her that they were attached, but not happy. She could taste bile on her cardboard tongue. Pushing the fronds aside, she moved, stiff and clumsy, from her bed. Mosquitoes had found her, and the squadron followed her as she felt around for her bag. The usual synapses reached out for Hiria and still found no response. Something cracked behind her in the undergrowth, a sound that she knew could only be made by the weight of a human. She clambered back towards the tree and turned. The figure was crouched low, and she could see eyes peering from the face of a man. She could see that he held a rope with a bundle tied to the end of it. Rays of light soaked through the clearing, and Oreo could make out the person's dark and curly hair. He wore a blanket of layered fibers that flickered up at the ends. Her eyes rested on the bundle dangling from the rope and saw a mass of black feathers, the cord wrapped around clawed feet. She could see three heads. One of them had a long, curved beak flanked by wattles on either side. The realization of what she was looking at hit her like a branch in the face. "Kohuya!" she exclaimed. "You killed them!" Oreo's hand scrambled for something to protect herself, finding only a detached tree frond, which she held out limp in front of her. At the same time, she edged forward. She had to see. He threw the birds at her as if to stop her from coming any closer. They landed at her feet, and she crouched down to pick them up. The birds were larger than the ones she was used to handling. She could see now that they weren't kohuia at all, but something much, much more confusing. Oreo brushed her shaking fingers over the leathery orange wattles, a color they hadn't achieved in the lab. Her tears rolled off the surface of the feathers and into the dirt. She looked back up at the man, wondering how afraid of him she needed to be. "Where did you find these?" Her voice sounded strangled, the panic sucking air from her lungs. They couldn't be from this part of the forest or any forest that she knew. Oreo lifted out the stiff wings, uncurling the recently immobilized feet. Live huia hadn't been here for almost 200 years. These were a deep black, not the grey-blue of hybrid kohuia. She couldn't believe that someone had unraveled the genetic mechanisms underlying the orange wattles and not passed the information on to their lab. She pressed him again. "Where did you find these huia?" He remained silent, and fear gleamed from the whites of his eyes. She could feel herself shaking but kept her voice steady. "No hea e ne huia." "No ko ne." "Ehara," she yelled back at him. Startled, he edged backwards and said something under his breath. His words flowed around and over each other like a flock of birds changing direction. They were both familiar and unfamiliar, and the effect was disconcerting. His eyes trailed over her jumpsuit.
"He turehu kwe?"
"Turehu, me! Turehu yourself!" Oreo was stunned that he didn't recognize her. Who was this caveman? "Why the hell would you think I'm a turehu?" Oreo said in Māori, trying to think past the fog that gathered in her head. His attention turned to something nearby and he signaled her to be quiet. In a smooth motion, he pulled the string of dead birds back to him and tied the cord under his belt. The chirping of the birds above was growing louder as the day lightened. He seemed to be listening to something beyond the clearing, something that Oreo couldn't isolate from the frenzy of chattering bird talk. She became aware again of how cold it was, her thin jumpsuit sucking it all in. She wanted to get moving, to go home. If she could convince the man to let her have the birds, she'd be out of there. Her eyes drifted back to the dead huia, now hanging from his belt, wondering why they hadn't been able to determine the genetic mechanisms underpinning the wattle color. The memory felt undefined, like a doughy ball, changing shape as she pressed for it. Out of the many obstacles they'd faced in piecing together a genome for kohuia, orange wattles seemed minor. They used chimera kōkako with huia DNA from museum specimens inserted into their primordial germ cells. Two chimera kōkako mated together produced kohuia offspring, a bird the same size and shape as a huia, but with blue-gray feathers and bright blue wattles. The man whistled a crisp bird call that cut through the cold air. Oreo closed her eyes to listen closer, the sound indistinguishable from any made by a bird. A moment later, an identical call was returned from only a few meters away. A large female huia hopped onto the lowest branch of a young sapling. Oreo looked on, her brain struggling to keep up. The movements of this bird were slower than kohuia. The kohuia tended to act and sound more like a kōkako who liked to ghost through the forest. But this bird seemed more curious than wary. Kohuia also flew more than their huia ancestors, who preferred to fly short distances from tree to tree or hop around the ground. Oreo forced herself to look away from the huia and back at the man. Both of them, relics from the past, as if she was the one out of place. In a quick movement, the man picked up a thin shaft of the ground that Oreo hadn't noticed before. Fluid, the spear left his hand on a path towards the huia. She leapt forward to intercept it, and the spear embedded itself in the palm of her hand. In the corner of her eye, she could see it jutting out from her hand. The man looked bewildered as he edged towards her, his palms raised. The nerves in her hand prickled, sending shockwaves up her arm. She forced herself to look down and saw that the stick, about 70 centimeters long, was more like a long dart than a spear. Oreo sunk to the ground, feeling woozy. As he grabbed her hand, the sharp smell of wood smoke and feathers floated around her. The spear was wedged into the fatty pad of her thumb, the tip protruding about 2 centimeters. He dropped her hand to rest in her lap while he looked through the contents of his belt. It was woven from harakeke only 1 or 2 millimeters thick. The single piece was folded into the center 4 times to create a pouch, and the ends plaited together to make the belt tie. He pulled out a thick pad of soft moss that she recognized as angiangi, along with a shell filled with a fatty balm or gel. She wanted to inspect it, but the man picked up her hand again and gave the spear a quick tug. Blood filled the hole but didn't spill over. He dipped the moss into the balm and then pressed it to the hole in her hand.
"Mau e pupuri," he said.
She held the moss to the wound and felt it throb in response to the pressure. Inside the folded belt was a bundle of soft-looking leather strips that Oreo thought might be birdskin. She noticed scars, crisscrossed pink lines against his dark skin as if sharp claws had torn at him. He was older than she'd initially thought, seeing lines appear around his eyes and across a concerned forehead.
"No he akwe?" she forced herself to ask.
He glanced at her, then shook his head, speaking slowly as if she might not understand.
"Kaore au mo te ki atu, he turehu ke kwe."
"I'm not a turehu. My mother is Lydia Ngātapu, for God's sake." Oreo waited for him to nod in recognition, as everyone else did. Her mother, practically the Princess Te Puia of genetic rescue, was well known for her work. But he said nothing while wrapping the soft leather around her hand before tucking the end under itself. Oreo flexed her fingers. The bandage was tight, but not enough to cut off the circulation. Something rustled in the leaves, and she saw that another huia had joined them. This one, a male. The other bird, probably its partner, didn't seem at all bothered by the humans. The idea of killing one of these birds was repulsive and would be to anyone she knew. But not this guy, who acted like she was the one being weird about it. "What are you going to do with those birds?" She nodded towards the pile of dead huia. Oreo had seen paintings of a time when huia lived in the tens of thousands. They had been used to make accessories, a whole head pushed through an earlobe with the body hanging behind, draped over the wearer's shoulder. The man ignored her, turning his attention to the huia prying a chunk of soft bark from a rotten log. He called them again, the long and short notes mimicking theirs perfectly. The birds continued their foraging, but seemed to keep him in their line of sight. The melody of his call started to take form in her head, each note lighting up behind her eyes. She stood up and took some shaky steps to her mother's tree, the sound digging up a memory. She was a kid at the old Pukaha Wildlife Reserve, standing outside the old aviary called Free Flight. A recorded voice played loudly over speakers, a mihi to the forest and its guardians. Then a bird call whistled by a man. It danced along the same notes.
Ke te wehe au. He gathered up his things and stood. Oreo felt a tinge of relief quickly replaced by panic. He'd be killing more birds.
Ka hemo o I te hiakai, Oreo blurted out. Maku ngā huia?
He frowned and pulled at the rope on his belt. The knot unraveled and the three dead huia landed on the ground with a thump, and he was gone. Oreo felt an urge to go after him. It was like the man had walked out of a hole in the hillside, bringing birds along with him. She assured herself that once she was home and reconnected with Hiria, it would be easy to track him down. She had evidence to prove that she hadn't lost her mind in the forest. That at least was something. Dizziness hit as the pain from her head spread through her body. Oreo took some shaky steps around the clearing to search for her bag, remembering that the dead and defrosted kohuya was still in there. After kicking at piles of leaf litter and ferns and finding nothing, she wondered if the man might have taken it while she slept. Although that seemed unlikely if he really thought she was a turehu. She looked up into her mother's tree to where the wakako iwi sat between the tightly wound vines. Her eyes wandered from branch to branch, but the deeply carved patterns were no longer visible. The box was gone. She sat at the base of the tree on her pile of fern fronds, the dead birds resting at her feet. Home was starting to feel very far away. Oreo sent another thought out to Hiria, a faint and feeble distress call. She'd wanted to be free of her, and that's what she imagined Hiria whispering to her now. Anna, kua watea koe. That's what you wanted, wasn't it? It occurred to her that perhaps this was all Hiria, a punishment for blocking the AI. But even Hiria couldn't simulate the pain in her hand and the deep throb in her head. The birds lay heavy at her feet, their dead eyes covered in a watery glaze. It occurred to her that she'd never seen their real eyes before, just the plastic beads of reconstructed museum specimens. She leaned her head back hard against the tree, as dots of light swam in the darkness behind her half-closed eyes. She wondered if she stayed there long enough and let the vines grow over her, a helicopter might eventually arrive carrying her mother's bones. Oreo knew that she needed to start walking. She stood up, using the trunk of her mother's tree to steady herself and slung the birds over her shoulder. The forest grew darker with each downhill step, and by midday the sun barely pierced through the leaves. Although her eyes couldn't see much, her ears, soaked in the multitudes of bird conversations, layering the air dense and spectacular. The path also became very narrow, and Oreo had to put one foot in front of the other to stay on it. It was unreasonable to think the place was different, except it was. The severity of the darkness reminded her of descriptions of the forest before it was burned out of existence, such as the need for torches while the daylight was restrained beyond the canopy. She wondered again if Hiria could have orchestrated this situation. Although she did like to punish in the form of snarky comments, this was beyond her scope. As an AI, she lacked the purpose. The simulated environments that Oreo had experienced were just like any other story. You choose to be immersed in it and could opt out any time. There was no opt-out of this scenario that Oreo could see. By the time Oreo reached the area that should have been the car park with signposted directions to the different whare within the kāinga, she didn't expect it to be there. From the hill behind where the small village had been, she saw columns of grey smoke against the darkening pink sky, signs of another papa kāinga. Given the turehu status she'd earned with the man, approaching the village seemed like a bad idea. The three huia were heavy. They pulled her towards the ground, and the rope had rubbed her shoulder raw. Hunger punched at Oreo's stomach, echoed by the ache in her hand. She thought about how she'd lied to the man about wanting to eat the birds when in reality, she'd eat her own wounded hand first. This wasn't reality, though, was it? Not hers, anyway. There was an area further up the hill that she knew well, large boulders piled onto the hillside. Oreo and her cousins played behind the rocks as kids. She would go there, make a fire, and maybe even cook the huia over it.